हेलो, ग्रीटिंग्स फ्रॉम गवर्नमेंट संस्कृत कॉलेज विजयनगरम। टुडे आई एम जस्ट गोइंग टू डील विद समथिंग वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट रिसेंटली। नैक बैंगलोर हैज रिकमेंडेड फॉर प्रोविजनल एक्रेडिटेशन फॉर कॉलेजेस, where our honorable vice chairperson inaugurated this. And as NAC suggested and recommended and thought that this is very important to make the institutions get accredited with the NAC in the coming days, because there is huge number of colleges left over without any accreditation. In this connection, in this background, really NAC has worked a lot and come up with a provisional accreditation for NAC colleges, for colleges. This is called as PSE. Its aim, main motto of NAC is to make accreditation process easy, accessible, and affordable for non-accredited institutions in respect of region, that is urban, whether it is rural, tribal, or any hilly area. So NAC has now come up with provisional accreditation for colleges, that is PSE, in line with NEP 2020. It is to enhance access, equity, and inclusiveness in NAC's assessment and accreditation process. We have now brought NAC modified manual for affiliate colleges, which is in line with NEP 2020. This is all due to the efforts of NAC and its team. Really, kudos to our Honorable Director, Sir Professor S. A. Sharmaji, for making all the efforts and his team to make accreditation possible by the set targets of NEP 2020. Yes, accreditation is a quality initiative. It is now affordable. And the HAS to encash the opportunities. There is an unified evaluation manual. And of course, in this recent RAF, there is a 42% of metrics reduction of data collection, where 96 to 50, 55 metrics now. There is increased clarity in parameters, and also there is lot much about the stakeholders and holding also is there. It's all due to the very innovative and painstaking step by NAC Director Professor Sharmaji. Now, if you assess, if you observe this the college status as per the AISHA report 2019-20, there are about 1,043 universities are there, and the number of colleges are 42,343. So this is a huge number. If you compare this number with accredited colleges or accredited institutions of higher education, there are, as per AISHA report, there are 42,343 colleges, but so far only 2,288 colleges were accredited based by NAC February report. So if you observe this RF grade declared institutions by grade, there are only 2,288 colleges are accredited, whereas only 163 universities are accredited so far. So for this, it is a very huge amount of colleges or universities are yet to be accredited. So NAC has come up with a very innovative this thought called provisional accreditation of colleges. So what the NAC has suggested and what the thought is to widen the horizon of accreditation, thereby inviting more number of higher education institutions to adapt quality through provisional accreditation. The provisional accreditation is granted to colleges in the planning stages of its assessment and accreditation. The objectives of the process are to identify the colleges which are eligible to apply for the comprehensive assessment and accreditation by NAC, to provide feedback to the applicant colleges regarding specific improvements needed for reaching the threshold level of quality, to handhold, to sensitize and motivate the colleges to come forward for assessment and accreditation process of NAC, The provisional accreditation approach is more comprehensive and directional. The status of institutional accreditation is based on the recommendations of the peer team verification of the peer team visit. So in this aspect, the colleges who are not accredited are eligible to apply again after a period of 6 months, but within 1 year of date of result of declaration, with a processing fee of 10,000 rupees plus GST and plus actual logistics fee, including the GST peer team visit is recommended. The peer team shall comprise of 2-member teams consisting of 1 vice chancellor, director, professor, and 1 principal of the similar type of institution. There may be an observer from affiliating university, state government, NAC nominee on the need basis. The college should comply with the public disclosure of all documents submitted to NAC in the college website in PDF. So this is very, very important. Any violation or modification of documents during the assessment shall be viewed seriously again. The provisional accreditation of colleges is similar to graded accreditation for any claim benefits afforded to colleges wherever grade-based benefits are not insisted on. Yes, the coming RUSA 3.0 is also taking this provisional accreditation of colleges into consideration whenever there is a funding issue is involved. The college shall be provisioned with the independent ombudsman for a grievance redressal. So the evaluative pattern is different from NAC. Here it is very simple and very transparent. And the procedure is also very, very, very simple. So the evaluative pattern of QLMs, that is qualitative metrics, and PNMs, that is quantitative metrics, on the 3-point scale of 0, 1, and 2, score will be taken. Only 3 areas, that is 0, 1, and 2. That means each question is awarded with either 0 or 1 or 2 score based on the inputs. Therefore, a college has to mandatorily secure a minimum score of 15 out of 40 for getting provisional accreditation. So getting 15 out of 40 is very, very easy, particularly the college where the for government college, it is very easy. All the colleges, if it has got ISHA registration, they can definitely get this score, that is 15, that is basic score, so that college can be considered as a provisional accredited with NAC. So any college offering regular programs of higher education at undergraduate and above levels are eligible to apply for provisional accreditation for colleges, that is PAC, provided such colleges must have completed at least 1 academic year from student admission to announcement of results. That is, the student has to enter and exit at least one year of his program. The validation of PAC will be valid for only 2 years. Colleges cannot opt for PAC for more than 2 consecutive times. And the provisional accreditation of colleges shall not be associated to any cycles of accreditation. The accreditation fee of provisional accreditation of colleges shall be 10,000 plus GST plus actual logistics if the peer team is recommended. The outcome of a PAC, that is a provisional accreditation of college, shall be in binary in nature, that is whether it is provisional accredited or not. That means if it is not accredited, it is considered as not accredited. If it is accredited, it is considered as a provisionally accredited. Outcome for provisional accreditation is a certificate by NAC and evaluative report. Any college applying for PAC should fill and submit the following pro forma through online. The fee paid for PAC may not be refunded, adjusted under any circumstances. Yeah, coming to this basic information pro forma, this pro forma is like this, the simple pro forma. So basically it asks for the ISHA ID. So ISHA ID is very important. So I request all the colleges to and get the idea after registering your institution and submitting all the required data that is asked by the ISHA All India Survey on Higher Education. Yeah, I think most of our colleges already submitted this. Maybe February 28th is last date. So in this pro forma, the basic details like institution name, date of establishment of the institution, whether institution has its own building or not, and name of the head of the institution or designation, address, state or union territory, city, PIN code, phone numbers, mobile numbers, and register mail, etc. They will ask. And location of the college, whether it is urban, rural, semi-urban, tribal area, or hilly area, has the institution completed 1 year academic year? You have to mention yes or no. If yes, mention academic year and the type of the college, whether it is shift, day or night or evening. And by gender also, they can ask whether it is the boys' college, girls' college or co-education. And by management also, they will ask whether it is managed, privately managed or aided or unaided, or any government like this. And the status of the college, and you need to upload these documents to this given portal. And the name of the jurisdiction of the college under the university, you have to upload the university affiliation certificate. The statutory regulatory authority is SRA, if applicable, upload the documents given by your university and UGC, etc. And Association of Indian Universities degree equivalent certificates, if applicable. And a number of faculty with doctoral degrees or equivalent. And number of programs offered to upload the self-declaration. And list of mandatory committees. The management information system, that is MIS, is whether it is in place or not. Luckily, all our colleges are in MIS, so there is no issue. And whether CBCS is implemented across the state, we are now implementing, whether it is private, government, or aided, or unaided. And undertaking in the prescribed format on the college letterhead, so upload the undertaking prescribed by NAC. This format is also given, supplied by NAC. So these are different format, any institution can submit either easily. And there are two types of questions. One is quantitative, another one is qualitative questions. So at each level, in quantitative questions, there are 10 questions are there. In qualitative, there are again 10 questions are there. Each question carries 2 marks at the maximum. So the total marks for this quantitative as well as qualitative is only 40 marks. So the required score from this 40 is only 15. So all our colleges can easily go for this frozen accreditation if it's not accredited, or the colleges, even the college who do not have 2F or 12B status also can go for this frozen accreditation of colleges. So let us see what are the qualitative questions, the 10 questions available here. As it is suggested that there are only 3 types of scoring. So one is 0, another one is 1, and finally, that is a 2. If you reach the metric-wise benchmarks, maximum benchmark you can score, you can award 2 marks. If you are on an average, you can award 1 mark. And if you are not reaching this minimum criteria, you can award 0 marks. Like this, you can every institution or every case team can self-check this. So self-evaluation is very much important. So you can also self-evaluate your institution regarding these quantitative as well as qualitative questions. So coming to this quantitative question number 1, that is percent of teachers against sanctioned required post or full-time teachers. It is again, if less than 50 is there, it is 0, you can award 0. If there is 52, 75%, you can award 1. If there is more than 75%, you can award 2. So luckily, all the government colleges now, at this situation, they can score 2 out of 2, because in all the colleges, there are more than 75% regular faculty are there due to this recent scenario. So we can easily score maximum benchmark here, that is 2 out of 2. Coming to the second point, that is student-teacher ratio, again, due to maybe online admissions or due to COVID scenario, almost all the colleges, there is full student and teacher ratio that is very compatible when we compare to the earlier days. If it is 50 is to 1 or less than 50 is to 1, you can award 0 only. If there is 30 is to 1 or 50 is to 1, you can award 1. And there is less than 30 is to 1, you can award 2, the benchmark. So even in this aspect also, we can score, get top benchmark. So we can score easily 2 out of, as most of the colleges, there is less than 30 is to 1 student teacher ratio. Coming to the question number 3, that is percent of students undertaking project work, field work, internship, dissertation, skill-based learning. Yeah, again, if there is less than 10, you can award 0 only. If it is 10 to, between 10 to 20, you can award 1. It is more than 20, you can award two benchmarks or two score. So most of the colleges, again, due to our skill initiatives and Johar Knowledge Center and other placement drives, our state is the foremost state when designing the four-year program. So we can score maximum here. And pass percentage of the students, question number four, again, you can score two out of two. And number of research papers, books, book chapters, conference proceedings, patents published, etc. Again, recently, all our faculty are doing very well in this area also. So for this, under this category also, you can score maximum score, that is two. And the student computer ratio, most of the colleges have very good number of computers. If you have more than 30 computers for each student, one computer for 30 students, you can score maximum, that is two, this is a benchmark. And percentage of classrooms and seminar halls with ICT facility. Yeah, all the colleges, almost all the government colleges, in fact, even private colleges, they have digital classrooms, they have virtual classrooms, computer labs, and most of the learning environment is taking place. So even the innovative learning practices and disruptive technologies are being used by our faculty. So in this also, we can score more, that is two out of two. The internet connection or Wi-Fi facility is available in this institution. Yes, every college has different platforms, different network areas. So in this also, you can easily score two out of score, that is top benchmark. And coming to the criterion number nine, that is the number of curricular, co-curricular, extracurricular, cultural sports programs organized by the institution. Yes, every day. We are doing a lot of curricular, co-curricular, extra-cultural activities, sports and games, where every day we are doing, and we need to document that. And in this also, you can score two out of two. And coming to the last metric under this quantitative questions, that is the number of faculty development programs, professional development programs, administrative training programs, orientations, and capacity building programs. Of course, the CCE as well as the APSHA and other departments, even APHRDA. Every organization that is connected to education department, they're offering so many capacity building programs. And you know, most of the time, the CCE in association with the different organizations also, and they have conducted this capacity building programs for particularly for the improvement of the faculty skills and capacities. Thereby, you can also score maximum 2 points here. So in this, if you observe, any college, any government college, in fact, any some private college also can easily score 20 out of 20 because in this quantitative metric questions, quantitative questions, there are 10 questions that are available. The maximum is, for each question, there is maximum score is 2, that is the low score is 0. So on an average, you can get at least 10. If the very poorest of the college also can get 10. Marks or score 10 here. This is about this quantitative metrics. Coming to the very important area, that is qualitative questions. Again, like the quantitative questions here, you find only 10 questions. So you need to write at least 100, within 100 words, whereas in NAC, they will generally ask for 500 questions for each qualitative question. Here, you can write, it is like something like a precise writing. So within 100 words to 300 words, you can write this under this qualitative metrics. And for each questions to be written along with the relevant supporting documents corresponding to the question. So for every writing, you need to supply the document also as evidence. So if you observe these questions, so first question is how the college assesses the learning levels of the students after admission and organize special programs to cater the different needs of the students. That is the first question. You need to answer very beautifully and you need to submit the documents as evidence. What are the student-centric methods such as experiential learning, participative learning, and problem-solving methodologies are used for enhancing learning experiences? The second question. And specify the ICT-enabled tools, including online resources for effective teaching and learning process used by teachers. That is the third one. The fourth one is mention the extension activities in the neighborhood community in terms of impact and sensitizing the students to social issues and holistic development. That is fourth one. Fifth one is disrupt the facilities for teaching, learning, that is classrooms, laboratories, computing equipment, cultural activities, yoga, games, and sports, etc. And elaborate the library facilities available in the college. How college reflects academic and administrative pursuits in line with its vision and mission, and how college effectively reflects the leadership in various practices like decentralization and participative management. Explain institutional development plans and strategies for achieving a long and short-term goals in the college. What are the quality initiatives, sustenance and enhancement measures taken by the internal quality assurance system of the college? These are the 10 different questions asked in this qualitative matrix, where you need to write within 100 to 300 words, and you need to support attach the documents wherever necessary, wherever required. So I would like to explain how we can write for each metric, that is qualitative metric, because it is very important. Many people are asking what should be written in this for this question, what documents we need to submit for this question, like this. So I would like to detail some of these qualitative questions. If you come to this question number one, that is how the colleges assess the learning levels of the students after admission and organize special programs to cater the differential needs of the students. This is very, very important and pertinent question as far as the students are considered and their learning levels are considered. So yeah, naturally we are doing after this admission, and the first activity we are doing is Deeksharam, that is student induction program. You have to submit that document because most of the colleges, almost all the colleges are organizing Deeksharam, that is student induction program. And most of the colleges, they usually conduct this advanced learners programs, the remedial coaching for school learners, and there are special measures to support the students, particularly the student support service also, you can write here. So this is the first question. You can neatly answer these questions and you can submit the evidences also. Like this, you can also take the pro forma available in this NAC DV manual. For example, here for learning average percentage of students benefited by guidance for competitive examinations and career counseling offered by the institutions during the last 5 years. In NAC, they will ask for 5 years, whereas here you can submit this document only for this 1 year, that is current year. You can mention that name of the activity, you can mention the number of students, you can support this list of the students also. Whether any placements are taken or whether any companies you have invited, and such documents you need to submit. Coming to the question number two under this qualitative questions, the question number two is like this. What are student-centric methods such as experiential learning, participative learning, and problem-solving methodologies are used for enhancing learning experience? Yes, we are all doing that. Only thing is you have to document, you have to write very beautifully. Here, some of the holistic development of student on cognitive as well as conceptual parameters by use of technology and innovation. Like this, you can submit and you can write. There is a creative thinking, creativity, and diversity. The implementation of vocational education, etc. Because most of the colleges are now doing project works and they are sending their students to internships and of course apprenticeships like this, under this new education policy also you can mention, because there is a vocationalization of higher education also is very important, where you have to correlate some of the especially the some courses like add-on courses, certificate courses, diploma courses, which can relate to, which can lead to this skill enhancement like this. And some courses like embedded courses are there available, easily available. Some of the colleges, autonomous colleges are doing, of course. And there is, because even though the college going for provisional accreditation, they are doing all these activities across the state, because thanks to the CCA, they're training all the colleges, they're taking information, they're day to day, they're giving suggestions to conduct all these programs. Hence, all the colleges are doing this, and we can score a very good score here. So you can take the pro forma, like the capacity building and skill enhancement initiatives by taken by the institution, including the soft skills, language and communication skills, life skills like yoga, physical fitness, health, hygiene, and ICT and computing skills also. So again, submit document and list of students who are participating in these different skill areas, like life skills or soft skills, etc., as a document. And not only that, there are different trends, new trends under this new vision and new education policy. This is also called as Education 4.0. That is, anytime, anywhere is there, the deployment of SWAYAM platform, the MOOCs, student participation in curriculum design, blended learning, and that is 60 to 40, that is online and offline, and personal learning, and bring your own device, project-based learning, hands-on training, data interpretation, logical interpretation, pedagogy, evaluation through application of knowledge, SWAYAM Prabha, independent learning, and teachers as digital teachers. And yeah, under new education policy and recent budget also, Honorable Finance Minister stressed upon this digital teachers and digital university. So most of our teachers are now becoming digital teachers. And the third question is a qualitative question, that is, specify the ICT-enabled tools, including online resources for effective teaching and learning process used by teachers. So there are different apps are also available. Voice of America for English teaching, EFLU, that is English Pro. Spoken Tutorial app is there, CC LMS is there, MPTEL is there, and of course CSE Consortium of Educational Communication is there, and SWAYAM Prabha is there. All these can be used by a digital teacher and digital student. You can mention all this and you can document this. And coming to this question number four, that is under this qualitative metric, the mention the extension activities in the neighborhood community in terms of impact and sensitizing the students to social issues and holistic development. Yeah, in fact, we are all doing very nicely all these activities. We can showcase this and you can document within 100 to 300 words. We can also submit this in geo target photos. Only the basic differences we need to explain this in a structured way, that is, as per NAC, there is a steps for extension activities, that is, stage one is assessing community needs and resources. Stage two is sharing information about the HEIS program with the community. Stage three is involving the community members in the HEIS extension efforts. And stage four, shaping the community engagement through conflict resolution, etc. And stage three, there is dissemination of information to this maybe local communities, local bodies, or district administration, like this. So if you do all these things, yeah, most of our colleges are doing. But many times it is not documenting, they are not submitting this information to district administration or local administration. At least nowadays, if you take this inspiration, in every village there is a village secretary. At least you have to, when you are adopting a community, when you are adopting a village, when you have some connected a survey or you have done something work, some work, you can disseminate this information to this local bodies or district bodies also. If you listen to today's Honorable Prime Minister's Mann Ki Baat program, he specifically mentioned one NSS activity where the students transformed the railway stations by painting. So like this, these activities can be appreciated by our officials, can be appreciated by higher authorities also, because you are, after all, you are with your activity, you are transforming your society, your community, etc. So that is what NAC is expecting from education institutions. And coming to the qualitative question, that number five, that is, describe the facilities for teaching learning, that is classrooms, laboratories, computing equipment, cultural activities, yoga, games, and sports, etc. Yeah, we are doing very much. Most of the colleges are well equipped with this, all these resources. You have to document and you have to geotag the photos and submit to this NAC team when they're coming visiting to your institution. So average number of sports and cultural activities, events in which students of the institution participated for the last 1 year, you need to submit. Coming to the question number six, that is, elaborate on the library facilities available in the college. Yes, most of our colleges have beautiful library, and you have enlisted, registered, and you are registered in FibNet. and most of our colleges are having digital libraries also. Our Honorable Srinivas are also promoting the digital libraries in every village secretariat. So definitely we are fortunate that we can access all this due to Wi-Fi, high internet speed. There is another app is called as NDLA. I think most of our teachers, they have sensitized students to install, download this NDLA app, because there is almost 7 crore resources are available in this. This is called as a library in your pocket. PDF form, YouTubes, and there are movies, and there are books, journals, everything. So it's a very beautiful app. So library facility, you have to beautifully document, and you have to showcase this to get full score here. Coming to question number 7, that is how college reflects academic and administrative pursuits in line with its vision and mission. So every time you need to align with this your personal vision and personal mission, so that there are some steps available for this. Implementation of e-governance in areas of operational administration, when it comes to finance and accounts, that is fundraising and student education support and examination. So there must be decentralization of committees, there must be transparency. And thanks to online admissions, so there is a lot of transparency available, and we have MIS. So you have to club all these things when you are writing, answering this question number 7. And coming to the question number 8, that is how college effectively reflects leadership in various practices like decentralization and participatory management. Yes, almost all the colleges, we have different decentralization mechanisms. There's different committees like CPDC committees there, alumni committees there, and finance committees there. And so many statutory and non-statutory committees are available. You have to showcase all this so that through these committees, there is a transparency and there is decentralization and there is a participative management. Even the students are participated in some aspects of academic as well as non-academics, and of course the curricular as well as extracurricular activities. So each college, each institution has to showcase this document, write in 100 words, 100 to 300 words, how your leadership is taking all the stakeholders into this management. Coming to question number 9, that is explain institutional development plans. This is very, very important, and recently we have a beautiful and comprehensive institutional development plan, and that strategizes for achieving long and short-term goals in this college. Yeah, institutional development plan in general talks about long and short-term goals. Like this, there is a template for this institutional development plans, and you also ask feedback and suggestions from all the teachers, all the HAs across India. Of course, it is closed by 11th February. Maybe I think that most of our principals and academicians also submitted their feedback. So actually, institutional development plan is like this. It is actually a strategic perspective plan. It will have a vision and mission objectives of the institutional development plan, the need assessment based on wide consultations, defined by goals, priorities, and commitments. And you need to quantify institution's goals using indicators, using time-bound targets, and identify gaps and capacities of both human and financial, and take steps to bridge the gaps, design annual development plans, and IDP shall be prepared for 5 years. It can be considered as a living document. So this is very, very important aspect and important questions where you need to develop, where you need to document this for a short term as well as a long term. There is a institutional development plan. And coming to the last question, that is what are the quality initiatives, sustenance, and enhancement measures taken by the internal quality assurance system of the colleges? IQAS is the heart and soul for any college or any institution. So here the IQAS people has to plan, has to document, has to act, and has to, there is a PDCA cycle is there. So you have to implement all these things. For activities of IQSA, there is a performance also available, that is a project planning, literature review, establishment of key quality indicators and feedback mechanism. This is as a phase one. Phase one is a planning part and the preparation part. And phase two is data collection and analysis part. This is a PDCA cycle actually, as suggested by Deming, Professor Deming is an educationist. Here you need to plan a project, like understanding the definition of an institution, understanding the vision, writing the vision, and understanding the mission, the goals, and the objectives, and developing the institutional quality manual and quality policy, and trace and report institutional milestones, and allot roles and responsibilities to the core team. This is the responsibility of the IQC, where you have to assign different roles and responsibilities. So this everything is called as a project planning. That is the first part. And in this first part, again, there is a literature review. So you have to understand the external quality assurance process of the relevant agencies by studying elaborately, extensively of other SARs. And there is a knowledge and public resource, published resource available, and existing laws and regulations you need to follow regularly. So this is a literature review. And you need to establish the key quality indicators and feedback mechanisms. That is very, very important. You need to fill the institutional gaps, and you need to conduct the SWOT analysis. You have to take the feedback from the questionnaire processes and analysis. And finally, you have to analyze that where the weaknesses and where the strengths, where the challenges are available. You need to gap all these things. So this is a IQC should play a very important role. And the part two, that is phase two, is data collection analysis. The data collection, you have to prepare questionnaires, you have to record observations, you have to collect databases. And finally, data analysis, the metric-wise analysis, institutional gap analysis, SWOT analysis, and prospective strategic plan. So this is the main role depends on the IQC team. Like this, you need to go for preparation of the document under the PSC. So finally, there is a vocation of higher education as per new education policy, because new education policy, it is a document released in 2020, and it is, we are in 2022. So naturally, the NAC team is asking for, looking for this, that is practice-based. You need to have practice-based curriculum gap analysis, open and distance learning mode, that is blended learning, and exposure to vocational education, and knowledge developed in India to be made accessible to students, and skill framework. You have to design courses as per NSQF framework, and you need to develop vocational craft also, that is internships, apprenticeships, opportunity to, for the students to have internships at industry level. So all these you need to work out under this qualitative metrics. And finally, you need to have a look, you have to go for a self-evaluation before submitting to this PSC. That is, you can assign these questions, you can assign the scores from 0 to 2. Here, I can say that most of the colleges, they are scoring 2. Only maybe elaborate on the library facilities available in the college. That is one exception. Maybe some colleges do not have a wonderful and digital library. And some colleges need to design, develop IDP. Except these two, I gave almost, I have self-evaluated, taking my college into consideration. Except these two, I have given 2, because my college is a very small college, but even my college have all these things, so that we can get better accreditation. Definitely we can be accredited with this PSC. I think this will be very useful for the colleges who are not accredited so far, or very fresh colleges, fresh going colleges. It's really an opportunity given by this NAC. Once again, I thank NAC and Director Sir and the NAC people for having this to a very committed team to have this, because in the coming year, when the funding is, whether it is US funding or ROSA 3.0 funding, definitely whether they look for whether it is accredited or not accredited, whether it is, that is BSC is one or two, one is accredited, another one is non-accredited. Like this, definitely we can, all the colleges must be accredited with this very easily, that is not accredited college. This is about PSC. Thank you for giving this opportunity. I hope this will be very useful for the non-accredited college or freshly accredited, freshly going accredited college. Thank you very much.